afternoon. My name is Melody and I'm the founder and CEO of InspirEngage International. Before I begin, I just want to tell you about my day today, because you won't, I think it connects to the women in business thing. So I've recently given birth. My baby's now almost six weeks old, and he's tiny and the cutest little thing ever. And he's unwell at the moment, a little bit unwell, and I've been taking care of him all day. Haven't eaten breakfast, haven't eaten dinner, forgot to bring water with me, haven't drunk water for ages. Waited for my husband to get home just so I could give him the baby. And by this time it was 4 o'clock. And the train, the taxi was picking me up for the train at 4:30. So I quickly got ready, did my makeup, put my dress on. I didn't even know if this dress was going to fit me post-pregnancy. But I zipped it up, quickly ran out the door, got on the taxi. The taxi stopped at a neighbour's house down the road. So I'm in my heels, in the rain, saying hello, whistled. I mean, how happy is that? The taxi to see me, didn't see me. I had to run to the taxi, got to the train station. Train was delayed on the way by 20 minutes, which is why I'm late. And then I get off the train, super busy because it's London. Then I run from the station all the way here. I was fastest runner, sprinter in my year at school. So I can run. Not a good idea to run in heels because this happens. Your Stella McCartney heels will break. So then I carry on running in these heels, down the road, in the rain, and I'm here. And I'm sorry I'm waiting. Anyway, I'll be making a speech without the shoes. I don't know how I'm going to get home. So, being a woman in business is much more difficult than being a man in business. And I've recently learned that a lot more being a mother and an entrepreneur than I did before. I used to think that actually women can do everything, there is no difference. And there isn't to a huge extent. But when you have a baby, it is different, and I'm sure there are men out there who will feel the difference depending on their role as well. So anyway, so that was my little story about today. So I'm the founder and CEO of InspirEngage International, which is a social enterprise. Do you guys know what a social enterprise is? Who here doesn't know what a social, it's absolutely okay. You guys might be future social entrepreneurs. Okay, a few people are there. Okay, so a social enterprise is basically a business with a good cause. It's a business just like anything else. It makes money, but it makes money and reinvests some or all of that profit into your social mission. And your social mission can be anything that's a good cause. It could be, I don't know, eradicating hunger. It could be finding something for young people to do in your area. Or it could be what InspirEngage does, which is support young people and vulnerable women to develop the skills and confidence to be able to set up their own social enterprises, making money, becoming economically active, and making a difference in their community. And that's really what we believe the future of business should be, actually, to have a really strong social mission and also be economically sound. So that's what InspirEngage does. Now, how did I come to do that? In this little segment of time that I've got to speak to you guys, I'm going to cover three things. Firstly, a little bit about my story. I won't dwell on too much about that. Then I'm going to tell you a little bit about the sector and what's happening at the moment for women in business. And then I'm going to tell you a little bit about my tips for you guys, which if you go onto my blogs and YouTube channel and stuff like that, there's loads more, lots of resources you can use, but really briefly. Firstly, I was born in Iran during the Gulf War between Iraq and Iran. And, you know, and it was quite a serious thing. And our neighbour's house was actually bombed. There was a bomb that dropped in our street. And the alarm used to go, and we used to go down into the basement and hide until, the alarm was off, and then it was safe to come back upstairs. And that's how my life began. I had a really good childhood. My mom gave me everything we needed. I may not have grown up wearing Nike trainers, but I grew up traveling at least once a year to a foreign country, meeting different people, and having a wealth of experience. And that to me is so much more valuable than having, you know, things. So that's how my life started. We then fled as asylum seekers and immigrants to Sweden, where I grew up. And I experienced racism, bullying, you know, different kinds of things. But I believe that we make our own kind of... I think that our mindset determines your outcome. That is really the main thing. How you think determines everything you do in life. I don't believe in luck at all, actually. I say good luck to people, it's more a figure of speech, but I actually think that you make choices. You make choices subconsciously and you make choices consciously. And that ultimately defines everything that you do, everyone you meet. Have you ever met people and you think, oh, I've got such bad luck. I keep meeting like guys who are like this. The problem is you. That, you know, it is. There's good people out there, there's bad people. Your circle determines what you like in people and what you attract. Change the way you think, change the way you put yourself across and you'll attract the same thing back. I think take responsibility. And I'll come back to the responsibility thing at the end when I'm talking about tips, because responsibility and mindset is everything in business. It's not what you do, it's who you are, and that's what one of the things that is important is. So at the age of 13, when I moved to the UK, started year 7, English was my third language. I spoke in an American accent. My accent is still messed up. I remember my accent was trending on Twitter when I was on The Apprentice, because people were like, what the hell? Is she trying to be posh? Is she trying to be ghetto? Is she trying to be London? What is wrong with this girl? It's just how I speak, so I can't help it. But like, yeah, so I moved to the UK, and I remember I kind of thought to myself, there's got to be more. Like, if you want to be successful, whatever success means to you, okay? Not success, what the world deems success. Whatever success means to you. There's got to be more than doing the ordinary, you know, going to school, coming home, doing the school, coming home, whatever. Yeah, life doesn't begin when you graduate from university and you begin to begin your career. That's the mistake a lot of people make, by the way. If you've got younger brothers and sisters, tell them your career begins right now. It doesn't mean you just get paid as your career. No, your career begins. Everything you do in your spare time ultimately is paving the way towards a career, right? So I remember being 13 and we're thinking, there's more. I'm not going to go to school, come home. And these things, me being disadvantaged, what people call now disadvantage, a term I absolutely hate. Who's to say you're disadvantaged? I certainly didn't think I was disadvantaged. But you could say being an immigrant, asylum seeker, is not speaking English as my first language, being female, rah, 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 is disadvantaged, right? But I didn't see any of that. And at the age of 13, I became a co-founder of a democratic, national democratic youth organization. And during the weekends when my friends used to go and hang out, go to town or chill or whatever, I used to go to London on the train with my mum and used to come to Portcullis House or House of Parliament. I used to sit in boardroom type settings amongst MPs and different types of people and discussing things like petition or setting up frameworks or, you know, all these strategies and all these things. I didn't have a clue what it meant. And I was terrified. I used to honestly be so scared. I didn't like it. I didn't like it at all because I was terrified and I felt like I wasn't good enough to sit at this table. But I knew it was important and I understood the mission and so I pushed myself to go, even though I felt so uncomfortable. And I think that that's really important as well, is to push yourself, because you'll never grow if you don't feel you're uncomfortable, you know, because then you know you're going past a certain limit. So, and then we set up this organization, and now it's still running now, and a lot of the policies in London and in the country right now are because of the campaigns that we ran. So, you know, travel for 16 and under year olds is free on buses because of our campaign. Sex and relationship education became compulsory in the UK because of our campaign, and different things like that. So we helped make a massive difference, the young people and everyone who were involved. And from there, I did a law degree. I wanted to be a human rights lawyer. And it was really difficult, law degree. It wasn't easy. I'm not academically gifted. I work really, really hard, but I'm not academically, it doesn't come easy to me. And worked really, really hard and got my 2-1 and qualifying law degree. And then I had a place at Oxford Institute of Legal Practice. The 2 weeks before I graduated, I still graduated, I called them up and I said, can you hold my place for a year because I want to go and explore my passion, which is what I had been doing for 13 years. They held my place and I went and worked for a youth organisation. And after that, I thought, that came to an end, that contract came to an end after 2 years. And I thought, right, people want to pay me to deliver a service that I have expertise in, so I'll just do that. And it wasn't a business as such, like enterprise wasn't such a big thing, like I didn't know I was setting up a business. I had a Hotmail email account for £0, not even in my spare room, it was a room I rented in a house share, so it was my room, my sleep, my everything in one room. And I had a little tagline at the end of my email address, which was, what did I call myself? Global Youth Sector Consultant. And that was it. And you know, what I did have wasn't the fancy schmancy stuff, which sometimes people get so preoccupied with having a website, having a team, having money, having funding, having everything, which is great, and it depends what kind of business you set up. But more importantly than that, you need to have a very clear understanding of what it is that you bring to the table, what it is you do, and who you are. And that is, I think, the most important thing. Because deals are done between people. They're not done between fancy schmancy websites. Those are hooks. But deals are done with people sitting across each other and having the confidence, as Sue was talking about, having something, you know, a purpose, having something you bring to the table. And that is what will make a difference. So that's what I did. I set up InspirEngage International, and we work with, as I say, with young people. We do skills boot camps, training people to develop the skills and the life skills that you need to be able to set up a business. So we go and work with educational institutions, with corporates, with lots of different sectors. And across the, since 2009, since I set up the organization, we have reached over 1 million people worldwide, and we've got a portfolio in over 100 different countries, been all over the world, and really helped make a difference in communities, and that's really what matters to us. So that's a little bit about what I do. Now, going on to the sector. So, firstly, the dog-eat-dog world of business. How many people here have set up a business? Okay, a couple. How many people here are here, I hope, because you want to set up a business? You're an aspiring entrepreneur, a social entrepreneur, okay? And who didn't put their hand up on why you're here? Well, the business world is changing, okay? If you are sitting here thinking, you know what? I never liked the dog-eat-dog world of business. Neither did I. I didn't choose business studies at school. I hated dealing with money. I hate going to the bank as much as I do dentist. I just don't like business, you know? But I became very attracted to doing what I love and getting paid for it. And ultimately, that became business, you know? And I think that that's a good way to look at it as well, if you're a social entrepreneur in the making. And so the dog-eat-dog business world is changing. And I don't like that world. And you might ask yourself now, so why did you go on The Apprentice? Which is a very corporate dog-eat-dog world. And that was because I wanted to win, and I wanted to bring something new to the table. I was the first ever social entrepreneur to make it onto the show, and still am now. And had a great experience, and got to week 10 out of 12. And something I learned whilst on the show, and I think this is kind of true a little bit of business, women in business, is that if you're a guy and you're super, super driven, it's like, wow, he's really ambitious. I'm talking generally. If you're a girl and you're really, really driven and a go-getter, she's aggressive. And I think that is changing slowly, but in the corporate world, that has been the kind of the feel, you know? And I felt that on The Apprentice, although some of it is Edison, guys, it's TV, okay? So, yeah, live tweet about it on Wednesdays at 9 o'clock. I'll give you some of the insights. But I think that world is changing as well. Secondly, what was the second point? Wait. Yeah, this is the other thing, is if you're a feminine woman in business, and the way you're perceived, I was invited to make a speech at UNESCO, the United Nations Chamber in Paris, about social enterprise and community-driven things. And I was on the stage with two guys and me, and I was wearing this black skirt and heels and my hair, I had longer hair, and this red lipstick and whatever. And after I'd made my speech, this guy came up to me and he said, "Oh, Melody, you know, that was so brilliant, really made me think, it was really professional." And I stopped and I thought, I said to him, "Professional, that's a very odd way to, I mean, did you think I was going to be unprofessional?" And then he was honest enough, he wasn't English, an English person wouldn't have gone for it. He would have just gone, "Oh, sorry," you know, walked away. But he then carried on and said, "Well, actually, to be honest, I saw you walk on stage, hadn't heard of you before, and I thought, the way you're dressed and how feminine you are, I thought you're not going to be serious. I think you're just here to look pretty and, you know, and whatever." And I said to him, you know, "Thanks for being honest." And then I just looked at him and he said, "I realised that maybe that's more my mistake than yours." And I was like, "Yeah, I think it is. And let that be a lesson learned. And, you know, thank you and, you know, goodbye." And I think that that's the other thing, that if you're very feminine in business, sometimes you can be taken less seriously. Again, I also think that's changing, you know? That you don't have to be alpha female in business to be taken seriously. But however, the world is changing and the social enterprise is really contributing to that. So at the moment, social enterprise is being led by women and young people. 91% of senior management teams in social enterprise sector are female, have at least one female in the team. That's amazing. Almost 50% of social enterprises have female CEOs. Do you know how many percent it is in the commercial business sector? What percentage do you think are female in the normal commercial business sector? What? Shout out?
Seven.
No, it's 16. But yeah, better than seven, but 16 is still not 50%, you see? So the whole feel of business is changing. So it's never been a better time, ladies and gents, to start a business, because women are leading the way. They're really, the whole ethos and the whole dynamic of business is changing. And I think there's more support than ever, such as this, you know, Women Startup Program is really changing that and creating a real opportunity for you guys as well. So my tips, how long have I got? I'll be quick. So a couple of minutes, good, that's perfect. So my tips, okay? Firstly, who you are is so much more important than what you do. Please don't spend all of your time just thinking about what you're going to do. Spend more time thinking about who you want to be, what kind of entrepreneur you want to be. You know, when I was little, I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do, but I knew the kind of woman I wanted to become. And I think that ultimately the person you decide to be determines what you do. You know, sometimes if you're wondering, oh, I don't know what to do, focus on who you are or what you bring to the table. At InspirEngage International, we do an exercise called My Passport, where we help you build your story, where we help you build your identity and your personal brand. And that is the first module. That is the basis for anything. So that's the main thing. Secondly, then think about, okay, what are you going to do? And my tip to you is sit at your kitchen table, your wherever there's a big space, on the floor, whatever. Take a flip chart piece of paper, okay? Not a small little thing, because you're going to run out of space, and then that's going to break up your line of thinking, okay? It's all psychological. Big piece of paper, and then jot down everything. You know, sometimes you just have too many things come at you at once, moments of inspiration. Get it all down on this big piece of paper, right? And then distill that into one pager. What is your concept? So if you run into Sue or you run into somebody, tell them in one page what it will be. Ping it across in an email, because if you've got it down on one page, it's always, you're clearer, they're clearer, everything's good, okay? So that's the thing. Secondly, men are not the biggest barriers to women's success. Unfortunately, it's usually women are the biggest barrier to women, okay? And we need to change that, ladies. We need to take control of that, and we need to change that. Quick story, okay? I talk about this story because I just think, one, it's funny, and two, it just explains my point. Many years ago, when I was younger and fitter and had more time, I was in a bar, right? And Saturday night, and I'm looking around, whatever, standing with my friends, and I see this girl, right, across the room, and I have a husband, it's not like that, it was just, she was wearing this incredible dress, she looked stunning, had this high pony, really sparkling, really lovely, she looked gorgeous, right? And I couldn't not look at her. But anyway, she looked around, and she caught my eye, and she goes, and looks at me like she wanted to kill me, right? Because she was thinking, what are you looking at? And then I tell my friend, hold my drink, and I walk across, and I swear to her, she was taking off her earrings, ready to fight me as I was walking across. She said something to her friend, I think it was, you know, let's go for this girl, or something like that. Because when I come over to them, they're like, ready to fight. So I come in close, as the music's loud, and I say to her, I just wanted to say, you look absolutely stunning. I swear to God, had I punched her, she would be less surprised. She was floored. She didn't know what to do. At that point, she would have kissed me. I swear to you, she would have lifted me. She was like, thank you so much. You know, and we have to disarm people with kindness. And kindness is major, the most important thing. Be kind to people. Support other women. You see something that you like, someone carries themselves well, you know, you see somebody who's pretty or really confident or says something really valuable, tell them, you know, work with them. See if there's, you know, some kind of value in partnership or exchanging, or just make them feel good, you know? And I think that is a really important thing. And the final thing I'm going to say to you is, Okay, here's a question. If I wanted to jump from here to that door, what would I do? I would jump. Okay, who said that? Okay, this is a logical answer. Good, okay? Right, so I have my heels up, so I'll do a little skip, right? So if I jump from there to there, what's the problem? There's only so far I can get, right? So what would you do if you wanted to go really far? Yes, exactly. You would do a run up. You would take steps back, okay? And you're going to encounter problems and setbacks. And Shirin Ebadi, who's an incredible woman, she said that the steps back you take are what allows you to go even further than you would have done had you started from here. You have to allow the difficulties and the challenges and all these things along the way to feed into what you're doing and allow you to go further and propel you. And I think that's a really healthy way to look at it. InspirEngage International is so pleased to be here. Thank you to Young Enterprise and to the Government Equalities Office for inviting us. We are working with women running a Startup and Stilettos program and lots of other programs that we're working to support people to become economically active through social enterprise. And I look forward to seeing you guys, you know, prospering and doing well. And keep in touch and let us know how you get on. Thank you so much. Thank you.